Good morning. Welcome to worship at First Baptist Church. We have a couple of announcements we want you to be aware of this week. First off, our next business meeting is going to be in a hybrid format, either in person or over Zoom, coming this Wednesday. If you would like to participate over Zoom, you will need to contact the church office to get the Zoom meeting ID and the password. And if you have any questions about that, you can see all the directions in the soundings that went out last week. Also, a breakdown of all that we'll be voting on was also submitted in the soundings as well. So pay attention to that. If you have any questions, please contact the church office. We want you to be as informed as possible to help the meeting go as smooth as possible. The other announcement is, you've also started to notice that we have had a couple of socially distanced gatherings, especially with the youth. Just know that we are doing the best we can, constantly are trying to monitor how we can be safe, but also be in community and fellowship together. If you have any questions or any thoughts or ideas, please know that we are trying to do our best to keep you safe, but also connected in love. Now, worship is one of the ways in which we do just that. So let us prepare our hearts as we go to God in worship and in prayer. Everlasting God, help us experience your joy. Help us feel your presence. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. Our scripture lesson today comes from the fourth chapter in the letter of Philippians, verses 1 through 9. Listen as I read God's word. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and my crown, stand firm in the Lord, in this way, my beloved. I urge Euodia and I urge Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you also, my loyal companion, help these women, for they have struggled beside me in the work of the gospel together with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Hello, friends. How are you today? We're glad that you're with us. In our scripture today, Paul is talking about being more Christ-like. And one of the ways he mentioned is about gentleness. And he said, let your gentleness be known to everyone. Now, being gentle might mean that you're careful with something that you can hold in your hand, like a bird's egg. But gentleness also can mean how you hold people's feelings for them, and how you treat people, and how you're gentle with their emotions. You're patient, and you're kind, you're encouraging, and it made me think of one of my favorite characters from a children's book. And let's see if you can figure out who this character is. I'm going to give you a couple of quotes, and I want to see if you can figure out from the quotes who this very gentle character might be. The first quote is, sometimes the smallest things take up the most room in your heart. Do you know who said that? Well, here's another hint. A day without a friend is like a pot without a single drop of honey inside. Now that's a pretty good hint. Do you know any characters that like honey? I do. Winnie the Pooh. Winnie the Pooh makes me think of gentleness. He's kind, he's patient, he's encouraging to friends. He just seems to make everybody feel better. He makes me feel better too. He has some friends that need that gentleness, like Eeyore. You might know somebody like Eeyore. Sometimes he seems a little sad. Sometimes he seems a little discouraged. But his friend Winnie the Pooh always seems to know just what to say to make him feel better. There's another friend, Little Piglet. Little Piglet often feels small and like he can't keep up with some of the other characters. But again, Winnie the Pooh always has a gentle thing to say to Piglet, to encourage him, to make sure he feels that he can do big things too. Yep, my friend Winnie the Pooh. Well, I think he shows gentleness all the time. He accepts everybody for who they are. He treats them all with kindness. He makes sure everybody feels special and accepted. And he lets them feel their feelings, no matter what those feelings are. Yep, I think that is gentleness. And you know what? I think Winnie the Pooh does act very Christ-like in how he treats everybody he meets. So today, I'm going to try to be more like Winnie the Pooh. Maybe we all could learn something from this silly old bear.
Thank you. In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. To reveal the kingdom coming, and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross. For even in your suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation, Jesus, for our sake you died. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. And the morning that you rose, all of heaven held its breath, till that stone was moved for good, and the Lamb conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was born, and the Spirit lit the flame. Now the gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not faint. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. Praise forever to the King of Kings.
How do people know that you're a Christian? And what is it about your life that makes people just know? They see it. I've been thinking about this question a lot lately, especially in the midst of such difficult political and racial climate. How do people know that we're Christian? Paul's words in Philippians 4 really help frame this for me. Let's jump into verse 1. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, my beloved. For Paul here, the people in Philippi are his crown, which is interesting language. You have to know sports imagery to really get what he's saying. Caesar Augustus was known for creating intense competitions, sporting events, if you will. Philippi, it was settled by the Romans, the city was, in the first century, and it was a place where these sporting events took place. If you go there today, you'll see ruins of an ancient gymnasium with a racetrack around an athletic field, even today. So Paul's using the language of the people. So let's run with this metaphor, pun intended. When an athlete wins a competition, they're crowned with a victor's wreath. These are the same wreaths that you would see in pictures of gods from centuries ago, like Apollo. It's a sign of victory or honor, and even more than that. In this moment of competition, your status is elevated to that of the gods. You just did something divine by winning a competition, and now you stand above the rest. Think of our Olympics. We crown the winners with a metal wreath. And even more fascinating, in biblical times, the victor isn't the only one who gets a wreath. So do the priests and the kings and the dignitaries of the winning people group. They also get a wreath. Here's why this matters. Athletes never win for just themselves. They win on behalf of their people, their tribe, their country. They represent the whole. They all become, in that moment, a mark of the divine. It's really similar to how the Olympics counts how many medals each country wins. You know, when Michael Phelps gets a gold medal in swimming, it's like we all get a gold medal in swimming. The whole is lifted above the rest. It's the same thing here in Philippians. Paul's using athletic imagery for a church whose city is well-versed in competition, saying that the Christ followers in Philippi are his crown. They are the winners of a competition, and they are like divinity for him. Paul's blessing the church and drawing on imagery that they are in a fight, perhaps a fight to the death, but they'll win as long as they can do what I'm going to read in just a moment. But first, a little bit more context. Verse 2. I urge Eudea and I urge Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you also, my loyal companion, help these women, for they have struggled beside me in the work of the gospel, together with Clement and the rest of my co-workers whose names are in the book of life. Now, Paul's addressing a concern here. There are two women, clearly in leadership roles. Now, this should put to bed any weird controversy today of women's role in the church, but if it doesn't, it's because people really haven't read deeply enough into the Bible, especially Philippians. But anyway, these two women in Philippi, they're at odds. Now, we don't really know why, but it's clear they have conflicting philosophical ideas. It's like one is a Democrat and the other's a Republican, and they've been working in the same church together for a long time. They've struggled beside one another, and they've been quite successful in the work of the gospel. They've both done great things, but they're at a philosophical impasse. You know, that's similar to today. There are people, leaders, in this church who are lifelong Republicans. I know, because you've told me. There are people, leaders, in this church who are lifelong Democrats. I know, you've told me. There are people, leaders, in this church who voted for our current president. I know, because you've told me. There are people, leaders in this church, who have already voted in this year's election for someone other than our current president. I know, because you've told me. There are people, leaders, in this church, who are lifelong Republicans, who are not voting Republican this year. I know, you've told me. There are people, leaders, in this church, who are lifelong Democrats, who are frustrated with this year's Democratic nominee. I know, because you've told me. Now, I'm not going to ever say who you are. That's confidential between you and your pastor. But I'm saying all of this to say, the philosophical divide that existed in Philippians, well, it exists here 2,000 years later today. I don't know if their strife was political for them back then, but I can tell you, ours is. Politics has created an almost irreconcilable divide in America, and I feel its tension all the time. There are people who cannot speak to another on the other side of the aisle. The lines are too dark, too divided, too controversial. And yet people on both sides claim to be followers of Jesus Christ. Both are doing the hard, co-laboring work of helping to make earth as it is in heaven. And this is apparently true for the church in Philippi with these two women leaders. So what would Paul tell them to do? Look at verses 4 and 5. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. In other words, find a way to make your connection with one another higher and more altruistic than your connections to what you are frustrated about. For the women in Philippi, this is that they should stay connected over worshiping and rejoicing together in the Lord. Worship and God's kingdom coming to earth is that higher calling, not their disagreements. For us as a church, should this be any different? We have to be people who serve a higher purpose than a love of politics or a love of just our country. We cannot be satisfied with making America alone more like our political ideologies. We have to be people who see how and to strive to make the world more divine, starting with us. The competition we are in is a battle for whether or not our souls will unite alongside one another to do the good, hard work of God? Or have we fractured ourselves so badly that no crown can be awarded to either side? It's a real quagmire that we must all wrestle with because we're all affected by this. And look what Paul says to the women in verse 5. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. Gentleness here doesn't mean pushover or soft. Now, the Revised Standard Version translates this word forbearance. This may be a better word. The context shows that these women have been in relationship for a long time. They're like an old married couple, and over decades, you can grate on each other. But with forbearance, you hold your differences in love. You're gentle with those you have friction with because the friction is nowhere as close as important to the love you share. There's a higher connection that puts you together. There will never be a time when the church only has Republicans or the church only has Democrats. There will always be both, and libertarians for that matter. Working to make everyone more like you is futile and the opposite of what Paul means by using the word gentle here. The competition is not won by becoming more political. The competition is won by becoming more like Christ. We must find a higher connection. We must see that our co-laboring doesn't bring politics to earth as it is in heaven, but rather our co-laboring brings love and peace and joy to earth as it is in heaven. And this is where it gets tricky and entangled. I'm not suggesting you just dismiss your political opinions altogether. Who we vote for and the administration that's built around that candidate shapes the trajectory of our future laws and finances and military, etc. Elections have consequences. I'm not saying they don't. But there's also the mystical reality that there's something higher and more divine than elections that's going on right now in our world. And we have to be aware of that thing, too. And that's what makes me ask the question, how do people know that you're a Christian? I'm not sure they will if we don't forbear gentleness towards the other. I think we could talk about this subject for hours, and I think we probably should. Now, sermons are meant to elicit a response, so go and talk about and respond with one another that you love, even those that you love and disagree with. Ask yourself and others, how do people know that we're Christian? I'll tell you, if joy and gentleness don't bubble up into your conversation, then you're getting it wrong. We have to be people of joy and gentleness. We have to be. Otherwise, we don't win any competition that moves the world closer to the divine. Our crowning achievement may just be that we can show the world that even in an election year, politics won't divide us. Something bigger unites us, and that is the peace and the love of God.